we might have to decide. One is the extra class, what I lost day before yesterday. I would like to compensate for it. So coming Wednesday will not be possible because we have a Senate meeting. Oh, Saturday also it will not be possible. Convocation. And I am having convocation duty. God. Okay, thankfully I didn't arrange one. Yeah, so I am in convocation duty. So I can't. So I'll have to ask you guys whether any day after 5 o'clock. Any other day after 5. Maybe Tuesday, whatever. So is Tuesday all right for you guys? Yeah? Tuesday is October 30th. So Tuesday, shall we have from 5 to 6:30 or something, at least 1.5 hours? Right? Okay, so I take it that Tuesday, 5 to 6:30, we'll compensate for the class what I was absent last Thursday. That is just day before yesterday. Okay? So we'll worry about it further. Once 1.5 hours nipta lenge, then we'll worry about it further. Okay, and one more thing is people who had been absent either for minor 1 or minor 2, I'm thinking that around November 15th, I'll try to conduct a reminor, which will cover the entire syllabus until then, whatever I have, you know, covered. So it will be consisting of minor 1, minor 2, and after that, whatever I have covered. So it will become like a revision for people who had missed either minor 1 or minor 2. So I am just conducting one makeup minor. Okay, it will be around November 15th. I look for rooms and convenience and then I'll announce it in Moodle. Okay, so we had looked at voltage, source, inverter, and we had looked at half bridge and then full bridge, both separately. And I said that normally what we do is square wave inverter. These will be normally square wave. What we are looking at as the waveform is square wave. And we also derived what is the fundamental. And we derived the fundamental peak to be 4VD divided by pi. I think this is what we derived as the fundamental peak if I am talking about full bridge inverter. So this was the case for full bridge. And invariably, if I'm looking at voltage source inverter, we are going to have... So we are going to have VD as a constant value. So normally what we look at as the source will be generally maybe a three-phase or single-phase rectifier which has 50 hertz as the supply. Can you please push the door or pull the door because there's too much of noise outside. And then you are going to have a three-phase diode rectifier, preferably. And at the output, we are going to have a capacitor. So this capacitor will be normally an electrolytic capacitor, which will be of very, very large value, 3,000 microfarad, 5,000 microfarad. That is the kind of values normally we are looking at. So very, very high value capacitor, because of which we will have a good filtering action. We'll normally see that the voltage is almost settling near the peak of whatever is the line-to-line voltage. So line-to-line voltage is 415 volts, about 560 volts. The peak value it will be settling at. And after that, we will have the VSI here. And this VSI output is going to go to the load. So this is the way the entire circuit is going to function, which means what we are having at the DC link, this value is a fixed value. This is a fixed DC voltage. It is not going to be variable because we put normally a diode rectifier. We want to have the control normally in VSI. If I can control the voltage by appropriately firing the devices in the VSI, then I should be able to control the output voltage. So if you may recall, we actually had drawn the full bridge somewhat like this. This is going to be the full bridge. And I'm going to have essentially the DC voltage connected somewhat like this. And of course, I should have feedback diodes. So I'm showing the feedback diodes as well. These switches normally are self-commutating devices like IGBT or MOSFET, depending upon the rating. Again, little bit of more detail. If I am talking about an inverter which is within 10 kilowatt rating, within 10 kilowatt rating, that will be essentially, so less than 10 kilowatt rating, which will be normally about 600 volts peak and maybe 10 or 15 amperes of current. These are generally made up of MOSFETs. MOSFETs are available for ratings less than 10 kilowatt very easily in the market. And they are definitely less expensive as compared to IGBTs. So that is the reason normally we tend to use MOSFETs for less than 10 kilowatt rating VSI. If I am having greater than 10 kilowatt rating, maybe until about 500 kilowatt or something like that, then I would like to go for IGBTs. So if I am talking about 510 kilowatt rating to 500 kilowatt, then I would try to use IGBTs. And if I look at the switching frequency, if it is less than 10 kilowatt, we may be able to go easily until 20 or 30 kilohertz in the case of MOSFET. So switching frequency, if I try to look at, this may be 20 kilohertz or around the range of 20 kilohertz easily. MOSFETs can go until 1 megahertz of switching frequency provided the power rating is really, really small. Please understand that whenever I turn off a device, the charge carriers have to be swept off. They have to go through recombination. Only after that, the device will be put into off condition. It will turn itself into off, you know. So you need certain amount of duration for the larger amount of charge carriers to be swept off if I'm talking about a larger current rating. So larger the rating of the device, generally the operating frequency will come down. I will not be able to operate it at as high a frequency as normally I would operate for a, say, 10 watt or 15 watt or 50 watt circuit. Compared to that, if I look at 10 kilowatt circuit, obviously the frequency of operation will come down. I will not be able to operate it at a higher frequency. So although MOSFETs, we say, are capable of operating until 1 megahertz, that is only meant for very, very small power rating, less than 50 watts or 100 watts. Whereas when I go for 10 kilowatt rating and above, I definitely need to bring down the switching frequency. If I look at more than 10 kilowatt rating, and especially close to 100 or 200 kilowatt rating, the switching frequency generally cannot go beyond 5 kilohertz. It will be generally less than 5 kilohertz. So if I talk about hundreds of kilowatt, I have to have a switching frequency of less than 5 kilohertz, because again, the amount of, you know, the current that is flowing will increase as the kilowatt rating increases. So it takes more time for the device to be turned off. So this essentially puts some kind of limitation on the on-off frequency that I can employ in my circuit. So that is the reason why this is generally, you know, dominated by IGBTs. But if I am talking about megawatt level drives, which are very commonly used in cement mills, they are also used in traction applications. For example, all your Rajdhani trains, if you look at, they have generally 850 kilowatt motor, four of them, simultaneously driving the entire Rajdhani train. So you have the rating of those Rajdhani trains, motors, to be very, very high. In those cases, generally, IGBTs are not employable again. And because we are looking at very high rating, any device from thyristor family, I should say. So thyristor family, you can say GTO, gate turn of thyristor, or the normal SCRs, but we have three different kinds of SCR, as I told you. One is converter grade, which is used in rectifiers. The next one is inverter grade, which we can use in this case, right? And light activated SCR. That's another third type of SCR where the gate requirement is really, really small because it will be triggered by light. Those are used in HVDC very commonly, light activated SCR. So thyristor family of devices are used for 1 megawatt and above normally, right? And obviously, because the current rating is so high and they belong to thyristor family, they are very slow. So even if I operate it, at the most, the switching frequency could be 1 kilohertz. Even this is quite high. At the most, nothing more than that, generally, 1 kilohertz. That is the kind of switching frequency we operate. Of course, a lot of research is going on in devices, so which is bringing down actually the constraints, which means the switching frequencies are slowly increasing, slowly and steadily. But as of now, it is still within 1 kilohertz. When we were students, we used to say not more than 250 hertz. And eventually it became 500 hertz. Now it is about 1 kilohertz. I'm sure within a few years, it will again increase further. So this is the way normally we decide on the devices. So very low rating MOSFET, medium ratings IGBTs, very high ratings thyristor family. So this is the way it works normally. But in general, in all the VSIs, we are not going to have any control over the DC output that we are getting. The DC output is going to be a fixed value, which is feeding into the inverter. But inverter will have the control. So whatever kind of control we want to implement, that will be done only in the VSI. So just to expand upon this, if these are the four devices, we had named them as S1, S4, this is S2, this is S3. This is the way we had numbered the devices, and we had connected the load somewhere here. Right? This is how we had connected the load. So the load voltage, if it has to be, you know, modified or changed, then correspondingly, the duration for which S1 and S4 are on, and the duration for which S2 and S3 are on during the negative half cycle, these two have to be adjusted. So whatever I showed as the pulse width modulation, last time I showed, in the last class, I had shown the pulse width modulation somewhat like this. I can just have the pulse for so long a duration, and I can have the pulse for so long a duration as far as the negative half cycle is concerned. This pulse is essentially talking about the firing pulses. What I give as the firing pulses to, for example, this is to S1 and S4, whereas this is to S2 and S3. Yeah. See, if you control, actually, if you put the thyristor rectifier, you are going to be able to control the DC all right. But you may not be able to control the waveform at the output of the inverter. Here it serves two purposes. When I employ PWM, like what I mentioned in the last class, it not only varies the magnitude, but it also varies the harmonic content that is available in the output waveform. But thyristor family of converters basically are known for making the harmonic content more and more. So it's not really helping us in both ways. It is probably helping us in one way, that is to reduce basically the magnitude of voltage or increase the magnitude of voltage. That I can do. Adjusting the magnitude of DC voltage I can do. But I cannot really eliminate the harmonic content at the output. So PWM, what we are going to talk about eventually, will eliminate the harmonic content or at least push the harmonics towards the higher frequency so that I can put a low pass filter which will, you know, send out all the lower frequency components only and high frequency components will be bypassed. So that is the way normally the sinusoidal PWM technique works. So whatever I'm showing as this, these two pulses are essentially going to the devices that are actually being employed in my inverter. So I can think of something like this. Let us say I have a triangular waveform like this, right? At the frequency at which I want to generate my AC output, okay? This is the control circuit voltage, not the power voltage. So this may be 5 volts, 2 volts, 3 volts, whatever. So this is a control voltage which I can generate using an oscillator, using an op amp circuit very easily. That's not a problem. Triangular waveform can be generated very easily using an op amp circuit. Once I generate this, if let us say I compare this with plus VC on one side and minus VC on the other side, right? In which case, I would be able to get, if I say that my comparator output is taken whenever this particular positive half cycle of the triangular wave voltage is, you know, that triangular wave voltage is greater than the control voltage. So that essentially tells me how long I will fire S1 and S4. So depending upon what kind of output pulse width I want, I can adjust VC. So by adjusting VC, so VC is generally standing for control voltage. I can say that as control voltage. So by adjusting the control voltage, I should be able to get whatever is my pulse width according to my requirement. So this is typically the case of generating a firing pulse using a triangular wave generator along with a control voltage. So I can imagine as though it is a comparator. If I am looking at it from analog circuit implementation, on one side I'm going to give a triangular wave, on the other side I'm going to give a control voltage. Now whatever comes out of this, this will be essentially positive whenever the triangular wave is dominating over the control voltage, right? This can go as the firing signal, of course, after amplification. Because what I get out of the operational amplifier may not be strong enough to drive my gate, MOSFET's gate or IGBT's gate. So I might have to amplify this. So in all probability, I will use an amplifier after this, right? Triangular wave, how I generate is a matter of detail. So if you guys have studied oscillators, you should be able to say that sinusoidal, triangular wave, so many things can be generated using an oscillator. That's not a problem. So now this amplifier output will definitely have a common ground, of course. There will be a common ground. And whatever is the output, that will go to the gate. So this has to be applied between gate and cathode. If I'm talking about a thyristor, for example. But if I'm talking about, let us say, an IGBT between the emitter and the gate terminal of the IGBT, I have to apply this. But please remember, if I am going to have a common analog ground, I'm going a little bit into the matter of details in terms of hardware implementation. Because last time, Tanai or one of them questioned, pulse width, where are you giving this pulse? So there was a little confusion because I mixed up analog electronic side of the power electronics and the power side of the power electronics. So now I'm trying to exactly say which goes towards the analog electronic side or control electronic side and what is the power side. Okay. So what comes out now, if this is a common ground for all the four devices, maybe I will have operational amplifiers. You know that there are chips that are available with four operational amplifiers in one single chip. 741 has only one operational amplifier, but 747 or something has basically two or four operational amplifiers together. So the ground will be common. So if the ground is common, and here also I'm going to have a common ground, maybe the control voltage will be applied with respect to a common ground. Now, If I try to apply this signal to the gate and this to the emitter, look at the circuit what we had. So I'm going to have each of this as emitter base collector or emitter gate and collector in the IGBT. So if I am connecting the ground here, the same ground becomes the collector for the other IGBT. So I can't afford to do that. I hope you understand. I have a collector here for the IGBT. This will also be the IGBT's collector, right? So here will be the emitter. So this emitter and this collector are connected together. So I can't have the common ground connected everywhere to the emitter of all the devices. In which case, this will be like a dead shot, because this is emitter of the previous IGBT. This is the emitter of the other IGBT. Both emitters will be connected to the ground. So you are just short-circuiting this device. That's what it means. So in the inverter, it is absolutely essential to have isolation between the electronic ground and the ground of the power, especially when I am connecting the gate signals to each of the gates and the emitter. So it's a pair. I will get two wires. One wire will go to the emitter of the corresponding IGBT. The other wire will go to the gate of the corresponding IGBT. So which means I necessarily need to isolate between whatever is available here at the amplifier stage. I should try to have some kind of isolation. I think I mentioned optocoupler earlier also once. So normally what we use is an optocoupler. What we use here will be an optocoupler cum amplifier. So what will happen in this case is, whatever comes out of this, I will connect it through a resistance to an LED. So this is an LED. And LED emits light whenever it is going to get a positive signal. Right? So this will be connected to a phototransistor. So this is a ground and this is a collector and this is some plus VCC. So if I may call this as ground 1, which is electronic ground, this will be ground 2, which is actually the power side ground, but all the ground 2 will also not be connected together. I hope you understand that. If I look at two devices, one device is here, another device is here. This is how they are connected, right? And this is the feedback diode. And I'm going to have the gate here, gate here. These are the IGBTs. So I will have to connect this ground 2, for example, to this. So I have to connect it like this. This is connected to ground 2. Or I may connect it to this point. That is also fine, because I have to essentially take the pulses across this. Pulse is taken across this. So I can connect one of them to the emitter terminal. The other positive point has to be connected to the gate. So this is how it is going to be connected. So I can show it as though this is connected essentially to this. And this gate is connected essentially to this. You get my point? So you have four circuits like this. Independently, four circuits like this. All the four circuits will be connected to the four devices what you have in the inverter. You get my point? So it is not a very simple thing. It is a pretty complex thing when you connect all of them together. You understand my point? So this is going to be my VDC power. So this is the power portion, whereas this is all the electronics portion. Right? So whenever I use an IGBT, generally it will be a must to use an optocoupler. IGBT or MOSFET. It will be a must to use an optocoupler to make sure that the grounds of the power and electronics are segregated and there is no dead short circuit between the devices which are being employed in the VSI. So we will have a large amount of, you know, accessories for the VSI. The power circuit may be this small, but we will have a lot of accessories in terms of firing circuit, protection circuit, and so on and so forth, control circuits, all those things, right? So this pulse that I am talking about is generated using this operational amplifier, which will have two inputs. One is the triangular wave, the other one is the control voltage, and the control voltage can be increased or decreased to adjust the pulse width. So this is essentially a single pulse modulation. Whereas if I look at, maybe I'm going to have a triangular wave at a very high frequency, maybe, compared to whatever I want it to be as my output frequency. And probably for the initial three cycles, I will compare it with plus VC. For the next three cycles, I will compare it with minus VC. So whenever I compare with plus VC, I will get three pulses which are positive side, right? I'm going to get some pulse somewhat like this. If I try to draw the pulses, I may have the pulses somewhat like this. One pulse here, second pulse here, and third pulse here. All of them will be of equal width, right? Whereas on the other side, I will have similar one with, right, three pulses somewhat like this. So I am essentially looking at, you know, multiple pulse being generated with a high frequency triangular wave and a control voltage. This can again go through an operational amplifier comparator to give me the output waveform, which I can amplify and so on and isolate. Then I can give it back to my gate, the devices, right? So this is generally known as multiple pulse width modulation. But in both these cases, I am really not going to get the waveform which is closer to sinusoid. Yeah. You have to have one more comparator. You need not add both of them, because you are specifically firing one particular S1, S4 for the positive half. And the other S2 and S3 for the negative half. So you can segregate them. That's not a major issue, right? So you definitely need to have multiple number of components, so many sequence of components. That's what I said. Compared to the inverter itself, this will become much bigger, normally. That's what it is. Okay, now if I want actually approximately sinusoidal waveform, we call that as sinusoidal pulse width modulation. So sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique is very, very commonly used for inverters whenever I want the output to be close to a sinusoid. For example, all your UPSs, they all use sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique. Home inverters, many of them do not use, but if they use sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique, it is advertised in a big way. Your home inverter gives you approximately sinusoidal waveform, so your motors will not make noise and so on and so forth. A lot of advertisement is given for that. All the large capacity motor drives which are run by inverters, they all have to have definitely sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique, you know, employed. Otherwise, the motors will groan. It will not be possible for you to run the motor effectively or efficiently. So in sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique, what we do is somewhat like this. I'm showing, first of all, one half cycle. So this is my sinusoidal voltage for one half cycle. Of course, it will continue on the other side. This is how it should be, right? This is the voltage I want to have as the output, approximately. And I actually would compare this with a high frequency triangular wave. If I'm not drawing uniformly, it is my problem, but it should be a uniform oscillating, uniformly oscillating triangular wave throughout. So I am going to have a high frequency triangular wave being compared with the sine wave. Please note, this sine wave is the sine wave we want to have at the output, but high power level, at high power level. And what I will generate as the control sine wave may be of 1 volt amplitude. I can use an oscillator very easily to generate with an electronic circuit a 1 volt amplitude sine wave. It's not a big deal. And I will be able to essentially adjust the frequency as per my requirement. I may require 50 hertz, I may require 100 hertz, I may require 120 hertz. Correspondingly, I may have an oscillator, something similar to voltage controlled oscillator. So in voltage controlled oscillator, according to the voltage you give, the oscillation frequency will essentially adjust itself. So you can have the oscillator generate the sine wave at variable frequency as per your requirement. Now, whenever I'm going to have the sine wave greater than, say, the triangular wave. So I'm going to have essentially at this point, I'm going to have the sine wave greater than the triangular wave. So I will have positive pulse, let us say. So I'm saying that when sine wave is greater than triangular wave, I'm going to have positive pulse. And when sine wave is less than triangular wave, I'm going to have negative pulse. Let us say. So I'm going to have essentially during this portion, I will have a negative pulse. And let me look at this again. Here the triangular wave is greater than the sine wave. So you get my point basically. I'm going to have wider and wider pulses of positive nature and narrower pulses of negative nature. Right? This is how it is going to be. So near the peak where I'm going to have wider pulses. So essentially I will have wider pulses, then maybe a narrower pulse and a little narrower pulse and so on. This is how it will be. So I am essentially looking at during positive half, the positive side of the pulses will be wider and the negative pulses will be narrower, and it will be just the other way round. When I am looking at, because again this I have to show it as though it is being compared with the negative side as well. So I am going to have essentially just the opposite. For example, maybe I will have something like this, something wider, then something further wider and so on. You get my point. So this is the way I am going to have the sinusoidal pulse width modulation output waveform. So all I need is basically a triangular wave generator and I'm going to have a sine wave generator. And sine wave frequency as well as the magnitude could be completely in my hands. What I generate as the sine wave, reference wave, modulating wave, I may call this as modulating wave because I'm talking about the whole thing as pulse width modulation. So this one is modulating wave. And this one is triangular carrier wave. So it is very, very similar to what you do in terms of modulation techniques that you use in, you know, radio waves and other wave transmission. So we are going to have mainly two quantities here. One is frequency ratio or frequency modulation index, which will be actually frequency of the triangular wave divided by frequency of the sine wave. And frequency of the triangular wave will be very, very large normally compared to the frequency of the sine wave. So if sine wave frequency is 50 hertz, the triangular wave frequency can be as high as 5 kilohertz. So in which case, I will have hundreds of switchings within one cycle. very clearly. So what will happen is, if I have multiple number of triangular waves within one half cycle itself, if I just look at one cycle of this particular triangular wave, the sine wave will look as though it is a constant during that particular sampling interval. You get my point? So it becomes as good as what we looked upon here as, you know, a control voltage being compared with the triangular wave. So if I look at every sampling interval, because of the duration being so small, because the frequency ratios are normally higher, I'm going to look upon the sine wave almost as a constant. So we said already that the control voltage what we had in the other case, single pulse modulation, decides what is the kind of output voltage I get. So the output voltage becomes almost proportional to whatever is the control voltage that I'm impressing upon my operational amplifier's control terminal. So in this case, that's the reason why each of these pulse widths will be roughly proportional to whatever is the sine amplitude, the sine wave's amplitude during that particular sampling interval or carrier interval. So during that carrier interval, whatever is my sine wave amplitude, that will decide the width of this particular, you know, the pulse that I am looking at, which I'm going to actually put as the firing pulse for my devices. So I am essentially looking at all these pulses emulating the sine wave amplitude corresponding to that particular carrier instant. As simple as that. So what I get ultimately, it doesn't look like a sine wave, definitely. But if I look at the area under the curve, it will look as though it is emulating a sine wave. But of course, I have too many switchings. So switching losses will increase, no doubt. This is one of the major disadvantages of PWM technology. Pulse width modulation, when I use sinusoidal pulse width modulation, I am essentially emulating the output which looks like a sine wave, right? In terms of the area under the curve. However, I'm going to increase the switching losses tremendously, because if I am having a carrier frequency of 5 kilohertz, the switching on and off of the devices will be done at the rate of 5 kilohertz. So the switching losses are going to increase tremendously. One more thing is that because I am switching the devices at a very, very high rate, so if I call this frequency ratio as MF, I will have all the harmonics beyond MF, because I will have superposition of a high frequency switching on the 50 hertz wave. Whether I like it or not, I will definitely have repercussions of having high frequency switching. So if I do the harmonic analysis, let us say if I take my switching frequency, for example, to be 108, I will have all the harmonics, actually MF plus or minus 1, for example. All those things will start appearing as the output side harmonic. So I will have 50 hertz component, agreed. But after that, the lowest order harmonic, which will be perceivable, that will be 107 multiplied by 50 or 109 multiplied by 50. If I'm taking the switching frequency to be 108 times 50 hertz. So I will have all the harmonics beyond this MF. And if I am going to look at those harmonics, they will be of good amount of magnitude. They are not going to be small magnitude. They'll be almost having, if I say fundamental voltage is 100 volts, even this 107th harmonic, 109th harmonic, and so on, will be close to 90 or 100 volts easily. So I need to put some kind of filter to bypass this output. So I might have to, so if I say that this is VSI and I have to essentially put a bypassing, so HPF, this will be a bypass filter. It will bypass all the high frequency. And whatever is the output primarily will contain you know, the sinusoidal voltage. Now this high pass filter will be like a tuned filter. I hope you understand, because if it is a tuned filter, L and C in series, it is going to offer very, very minimum impedance. You guys have studied about resonance way back. Recall it. Okay? In resonance, what do we say? Normally, we will have R plus JXL minus JXC. So JXL and JXC, if they cancel out with each other, R is the only impedance that is coming up in the way of any harmonic that I am talking about, where XL will be omega L and XC will be 1 by omega C. So I am essentially looking at something like this. This is my VSI. I am firing it with PWM technique. Right? And I am going to have a DC supply here. The DC supply, how it comes is a matter of detail. Right? And at this output, I am going to put a high pass filter, which I can put it with L and C, where this L and C will be tuned for any frequency higher than 100 times 50 hertz, 5 kilohertz. So if it is tuned for high frequency, obviously all the high frequency component will only circulate with the L and C throughout. And what comes out here will be mainly the fundamental component. So this will be low frequency component. And the low frequency component here primarily consists of 50 hertz. Right? Now this L and C, when I design, I will normally use the same equation what I use in resonance, 1 by 2 pi root LC equal to whatever is the tuned frequency. And I want to tune it to 100 times 50 hertz, 5 kilohertz, maybe 107 times, whatever. Now, as this frequency increases, L and C will be smaller and smaller. I hope you understand this, right? As I go to higher and higher frequency filtering, L and C will become smaller and smaller. Because L and C become smaller and smaller, the component size will also decrease. They will all decrease. So I can say that if I have a very high switching frequency, I would be able to push all the harmonics to beyond MF. Which means the high pass filter need to be designed only for very high frequency. If I do that, then L and C sizes can decrease. So I'm trying to look at the pros and cons of having a high frequency ratio. If I have a high frequency ratio MF, I will have only high frequency components in the output, because of which my high pass filter size becomes smaller to eliminate all the high frequency components. But the negative side of it is I will have multiple switchings. Switching losses increase tremendously, and my device should be in a position to handle this kind of switching frequency. Whether it will be able to handle this kind of switching frequency, I have to question myself for that particular power level, right? So in sinusoidal pulse width modulation, where I was talking about one of the important parameters as frequency ratio, the second parameter is amplitude modulation index. This amplitude modulation index is defined as whatever is the sine wave peak amplitude divided by triangular wave peak amplitude. So if I have a triangular wave peak amplitude of 1, whereas I'm going to have the sine wave peak amplitude of 0.8, we call the amplitude modulation index as 0.8 in this particular case. So If I have a sine wave and the triangular wave almost coinciding with each other, the peaks, then I call the modulation index to be 1. But at every point in the sine wave, I will have intersection with the triangular wave. So for every cycle of the triangular wave, I will have intersection with the sine wave. But if the magnitude is really high here, I'm going to have a wide pulse, which means if I bring down the magnitude of the sine wave, I will have smaller and smaller pulses, positive pulses. So the modulation index indirectly decides what is the overall RMS value I get out of my inverter. So if I have the modulation index close to 1, I will get a good amount of magnitude of output voltage. Whereas if I bring down my modulation index, what I mean is, if I'm trying to look at a sine wave, something like this. Initially, let us say I have a sine wave like this. And I'm going to have a triangular wave, which is almost same as the magnitude of the sine wave. In this particular case, I can say maybe modulation index is close to 0.9. Okay? So I would be able to get at least this width pulses. Whereas, if I make the sine wave smaller, if I just make it smaller like this, very clearly I'm going to get the pulse width here to be smaller as compared to what I got earlier. So this particular green wave, if I choose as my modulating wave, where the modulation index becomes almost less than 0.5, I am definitely going to get a magnitude of the output voltage to be much smaller because the positive pulses also shrink. You get my point? So this amplitude modulation index is going to be deciding rather whatever is the output voltage magnitude. So I would say even if I calculate RMS, I am going to have reduction in the output voltage if I am looking at the amplitude modulation index coming down, right? Whereas if I have a modulation index of 1, I will have definitely wider and wider pulses near the peak of the sine wave. Now, if I am actually going to use a modulation index greater than 1, right? If I use a modulation index greater than 1, then I will not even see a lot of intersection. During the mid portion, I will hardly see any intersection. So I will have a wide pulse. During this portion, I'm going to have a wide pulse. And I may have some intersections here. Right? That's it. So whenever I use an amplitude modulation index greater than 1, we call this as over modulation. So over modulation will bring my waveform close to a square wave eventually. If I go to extremely large value of modulation index, then essentially all these things will also merge and then I'll get a complete square wave. It is possible that I may have completely a square wave. So during that portion, I'm going to again reintroduce the harmonics. Until now, I was trying to eliminate the harmonics. I was trying to look at the waveform being closer and closer to sinusoid. Only high frequency components could be there. But the moment I have eliminated all these switchings because of over modulation, I'm going to see that I have reintroduced the harmonics. So over modulation, although will increase the output magnitude tremendously, it will reintroduce the harmonics, so it's not recommended, especially when I want sinusoidal waveform in the case of motor drives or UPS and so on and so forth. So we basically have two regions of operation, amplitude modulation index being less than 1. This is one region, which is preferred zone, and the other one is amplitude modulation index greater than 1, which is over modulation zone, which is definitely not a very preferred zone of operation. But if I probably want a larger magnitude of voltage, I might try to kind of, you know, go into over modulation, not too much, maybe 1.2, 1.3, so that, you know, at least there are still some pulses left over. It's not like everything is merged together, right? One more thing that we need to necessarily look at is that if I say that during the positive half cycle, S1 and S4 are going to be fired, and during the negative side, S2 and S3 are going to be fired. Right? So, I am having actually, if you look at the circuit again, I am having S1 here and S2 at the bottom, S3 here and S4 at the bottom. So, if I fire S1 and S4 for the positive side, after some time I'm going to fire S2 and S3 when the negative pulse comes. But if I don't give any gap between the turning off of S1 and S4 and right away release the firing pulses to S2 and S3, I will definitely have a dead short circuit across the DC supply. So it is very, very important to give a dead band between S1 and S2 as well as S3 and S4. So this dead band, whatever I'm looking at, so if I say that I'm going to have pulses somewhat like this. So let us say I have the pulses going like this. Something like this, right? So I would have fired S1 and S4 here, whereas I would have fired S2 and S3 here. So when these two go off at this instant, S1 and S4 are supposed to go off at this instant, I necessarily need to induce or introduce a delay of a few microseconds, depending upon what is the turn off time of my device. So I have to take into consideration what is the turn off time of my device. How long does it take to recombine? So the recombination takes probably 5 microseconds. Then I might have to introduce a delay of slightly higher than 5 microseconds. Generally, I'll introduce a factor of safety. Maybe 5 multiplied by 1.5, 5 multiplied by 2. So I might have to introduce a delay of 7.5 microseconds or 10 microseconds. So this, although the waveform is like this, it may actually start only a little later. You can see that the blue and pink are not coinciding with each other. Although I had actually done sinusoidal pulse width modulation by comparing triangular wave and sinusoidal wave, this slight marginal increase in the delay, that can again reintroduce some little bit of harmonics. This is a necessary evil that we have to live with. There is no other way. Unless we give a dead band, we will have shoot through. So to avoid shoot through, we introduce this dead band, which is probably going to, you know, kind of mess around with the harmonics that I wanted to eliminate. So you may have small amount of harmonics being reintroduced because of this dead band. This is one of the necessary evils that come because of the shoot through being avoided, right? So in general, this particular way of generating firing pulses, that is where I'm just comparing one sine wave with a triangular wave and then getting the pulses which are corresponding to the positive side and negative side. So this is generally known as bipolar sinusoidal pulse width modulation. This we call as bipolar sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique, which means there should be some unipolar. So we look at unipolar also. What is a unipolar sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique. Yeah. If I have LC, it is essentially going to give me low impedance path for a particular harmonic frequency if I am trying to tune it to that particular harmonic frequency. So it will essentially try to just attract or give low impedance path only to that particular harmonic frequency, maybe for all the higher. So I can make it as a high pass filter basically by tuning it for a bandwidth which is corresponding to 107 times whatever is 50 hertz to maybe 300, 400 times 50 hertz. So I can essentially make the bandwidth accordingly by adjusting the quality factor, right? So this will not take definitely 50 hertz component because this will offer a very high impedance to the 50 hertz component. So it is essentially looking at the parallel path of what is going to the load, because here is the load. And this is essentially not really a load, this is a bypass path. So this bypass path specifically is designed to bypass only the high frequency components. That's it. So L and C, what you design has to essentially go with this kind of equation, 1 by 2 pi root LC. So that is why L and C become smaller. Whenever I push the harmonics to the higher frequency, this L and C will become smaller. I could have done this very well even in a sinusoidal, in a square wave inverter, no doubt. But in a square wave inverter, necessarily I need to give third harmonic filter, fifth harmonic filter, seventh harmonic filter, and so on and so forth. And all of them are lower frequency. So L and C will become very large. So I can eliminate that problem by pushing the harmonics to a higher frequency. That's what I'm precisely doing in sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique. See, never is an inductance a pure inductance. We are happily relying on that. His question is, if L and C is tuned to 107 times 50 hertz, will it not work like a short circuit that the current will shoot up? But never is L and L an ideal L. It will always have a resistance. In fact, in many of the high pass filters, we will also introduce a small resistance. Only thing is, we have to make sure that the impedance offered by this bypass path is always smaller as compared to the load impedance. So filter design is again an involved area because of this. Because you don't know what is going to be your load impedance. Maybe you have to look at the worst case scenario. So if I know that always 20% load will be there, always it may not be 100%, 20% load is there, that is when the impedance is maximum on the load side. So for that I have to design my tuned filter for the worst case scenario, right? Okay, so let us look at unipolar sinusoidal PWM technique. Yeah. Yeah, okay. So let us get into a little bit of hardware. How do you introduce dead band? These days, whatever we have as microprocessors or digital signal processors, what we use or what are being used by my students, they all introduce dead band inherently in the programming. What they do is they already compare a sine wave and a triangular wave inside at whatever frequency you require. So you just load into a register what is the frequency output you require, what is the kind of frequency ratio you require, and then it just calculates inside, because digital signal processors have immense, computational capability. So they clearly calculate what are the pulse widths, and then they give out the pulse. So you have several PWM pins that are available in DSP, at least six, minimum six is available, because we always work with three-phase inverters, okay? So minimum six pins will be available. So those six pins will give out the firing pulses for S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, fine. When they give out, along with the computation of the pulse width, they also compute the dead band. Okay, and dead band you can again program. You can say I want 5 microsecond dead band, I want 100 nanosecond dead band, I want so many nanoseconds dead band you can give. That also can be given in a memory location. So it will generate the dead band and then give you the pulses. So if you actually look at the CRO, very clearly you will see between S1 and S4, there is a clear segregation. You will see that. In olden days, we had a tough time. What we used to do is, if this is our pulse that is coming to S1 and S4 pulse comes like this, we would try to introduce a monostable multivibrator delay. 555 timer, I don't know whether you guys have heard. 555 timer used to be our god, literally. So we will use 555 timer to, first of all, create a small pulse corresponding to, in those days we used thyristors. They required at least 50 microsecond or 100 microsecond delay. So we will put an RC in our 555 timer, which will work as a monostable multivibrator and introduce a small amount of pulse. Okay? So the monostable multivibrator can be triggered at a rising edge. So originally whatever comes out of our comparator, that rising edge we will use for triggering the monostable multivibrator, which will generate a delay of 50 microsecond or 100 microsecond pulse width. That pulse width we'll knot it and it with the pulse that came out of the comparator itself. So we will have actually the pulse out of the monostable multivibrator something like this. This and this will be anded together. So we used to do a lot of circus before we get the actual pulses, because we all worked with analog electronics completely. So when I did my PhD, I worked with 8085. That was the first time some microprocessor was introduced in our curriculum, and then we started working with 8085 and 8086. So we had never seen any of these DSPs or anything. All that I learned after becoming a faculty member. That's it. Okay? So this is the way we used to introduce the delay. Right? Okay. So what is unipolar sinusoidal pulse width modulation? So let us again take it for just one half cycle. So let us say this is going to be my sine wave for the first half cycle. So this is Vm sine omega t. Yes, guys, any questions? Lot of crosstalk. So we are going to have the reverse of this also being utilized in the control circuit. We have Vm sin omega t. We have generated this using maybe an oscillator. We can always use an inverting amplifier to get the minus Vm sin omega t. Okay? So this is my minus Vm sin omega t. Now I'm going to have, let us say, a triangular wave somewhat like this. So I'm just showing a triangular wave as though it is somewhat like this. Right? Now I will compare the triangular wave, the same triangular wave, with both Vm sin omega t and minus Vm sin omega t. Right? What are you looking at your mobile? What is it that you are doing? Batao. You guys do not want me to confiscate your mobiles, I suppose. Please do not behave this way. If you don't want to come, don't come. I'm anyway uploading the lecture, so what is your problem? Don't come. What are you really achieving by sitting here and looking at your mobile? Only irritating me, that is the only thing. That's all. Okay? So if I have a triangular wave compared with Vm sin omega t, let us say during this portion, this entire portion, I am having the sinusoid dominating over the triangular wave. So let me probably call this as the positive portion for one of the pulses. So let us say during this portion, I'm going to have positive. During this portion, I'm going to have zero. And similarly, unipolar, that's why I'm calling it as unipolar. And during this time, I'm going to have again negative. And during zero, and during this portion, I'm going to have positive. You get my point? So I'm comparing Vm sin omega t with that of the triangular wave, like what I did in bipolar. And whenever this is positive, let me redraw the circuit again so that we know exactly what we are talking about. So this is S1, this is S2, this is S3, and this is S4. So the first comparison, that is Vm sin omega t and triangular wave comparison, is going to provide the firing pulses only for the first leg. Only for the first leg. So they are essentially not of each other. So I'm going to have essentially S1 being fired here, S2 being fired here, again S1 being fired here, and S2 being fired here, and so on. You get my point? I have still not come to S3 and S4. So in the same leg, both of them will not be fired at the same instant. Please note that S1 and S2 are in the same leg. So S1 will be fired whenever Vm sin omega t is greater than the triangular wave. And S2 will be fired whenever Vm sin omega t is less than the triangular wave. Right? So this is one set. The second set would be, I'm going to compare minus Vm sin omega t with that of the triangular wave. That is going to provide the firing pulses for the other leg, the second leg. So if I actually look at comparison of these two, first of all, during this portion, this is smaller. The sine wave is smaller. Let me probably use. So the sine wave is smaller than the triangular wave, right? This sine wave, I'm talking about this dark color, whatever I have drawn, that is smaller than the triangular wave. So I'm going to have a negative, right? And if I look at this portion, only during this portion, I'm having the sine wave greater than the triangular wave. Triangular wave is smaller. So I'm going to have a positive pulse, right? Similarly, from here, right, I'm having the triangular wave being smaller, bigger as compared to the sine wave, minus Vm sin omega t. So I'm going to have this pulse. And from here to here, for a very, very short duration, I'm going to have again positive, and it is going to be negative until this portion. So this is all negative. And from here, it is going to be again positive. I have taken a very, very low frequency triangular wave just for demonstration. You get my point? So during all this positive, I'm going to fire S3. Whereas during all these negative, I'm going to fire S4. Right? Now, please look at what happens when I'm having S1 and S3 both being fired. This is actually my load. If S1 and S3 both are fired, it is as good as freewheeling, nothing else. You get my point? It depends upon in what direction the current is flowing. If the current had been flowing in this direction, and if I fire S1 and S3, this diode will take over. Although I am giving a firing signal to S3, S3 will not conduct. If the current is flowing in that particular direction, there will be a freewheeling through the diode and S1. If the current had been flowing in the opposite direction, it will be S3 and the diode parallel to S1. So I will have essentially either I will have positive voltage, or I will have zero voltage, or I can have negative voltage. So unipolar PWM technique, where I am going to compare the sine wave as well as the reverse or 180 degree shifted sine wave with that of the triangular wave, gives me essentially three level kind of output. I can have plus VD or minus VD or zero. So whenever I'm going to have a freewheeling interval, I will have necessarily zero voltage. Whenever I'm going to have S1 and S4 both conducting together, then I will have plus VD. And whenever I'm going to have S2 and S3 conducting together, I will have minus VD. So I can have three level output with the help of unipolar PWM, sinusoidal PWM technique, right? And second thing is, if I am going to have S1 and S4 conducting during this portion, let me write probably this instant as T1, this instant as T2. Between T1 and T2, I have S1 and S4 conducting together. So I will have plus VD. This is S1 and S4 conducting together between T1 and T2. After that, I'm having S1 and S3 conducting together. So I'm going to have zero voltage. So I will have multiple switchings now, almost double the switching of what I got in bipolar. Compared to bipolar, I will have double the switching in this particular case. But if I try to look at the devices individually, they are still not switching at a higher frequency because I have segregated. S1 and S2 are being fired with the help of one sine wave. S2 and S3 are being fired with the help of another sine wave. So the rate at which they are switching is still almost the same. But it looks as though I'm going to get more number of pulses than what I got earlier for the bipolar. For bipolar, the number of pulses I got was equal to the frequency ratio itself. Whereas here, the number of pulses I will get, because in between I will have zero voltage interval. So I will have necessarily the number of pulses doubled as compared to what I got in the bipolar switching. Which means, although here the frequency ratio is MF, it will behave as though the frequency ratio is 2 times MF. Because of the fact that, so for this, unless you guys do a little bit of simulation, it is difficult for you guys to really appreciate that right away. Or unless you look at the waveform that is either given in Daniel Hart or Ned Mohan or any of the books. I don't even want Dr. Rashid anyway. So you guys can look at how the unipolar and bipolar waveforms look. It is given in Daniel Hart, definitely, for both the cases. You would see that the number of pulses double in the case of unipolar as compared to bipolar, because of which the harmonic contents are pushed to twice the modulating frequency ratio. Right? So this is essentially going to reduce the high pass filter size even further. So the unipolar switching is generally preferred if I am looking at, you know, something like a full bridge inverter. But whenever we use a bipolar, we are essentially looking at maybe one device is firing and opposite of that is the other device. So wherever only two devices are used, bipolar becomes, you know, it comes in vogue. That is the one which is being used normally. So whenever I have four devices sitting, like a full bridge inverter, I can go for a unipolar. Whereas whenever I have only two devices sitting, where one is the not of the other, as simple as that. In those cases, generally, bipolar will be used as a rule. And if I look at three-phase inverter is only two device per phase. So invariably, we use only bipolar PWM technique for three-phase inverters, where I'm going to use only two devices for every phase. So S1 and S4 will be for A phase, S3 and S6 will be for B phase, and S5 and S2 will be for C phase. So essentially, bipolar switching is used in these cases. So coming back to the three-phase inverter, we just looked at 180 degree and 120 degree conduction mode. I hope you guys drew the waveform for delta connected load, because I did it only for star connected load. I hope you guys have done it. Okay? Because I gave you almost 1 week time, right? I didn't take the class since last Monday, right? So in the case of three-phase inverter, so this is S1, this is S4, this is S3, this is S6, this is S5, and this is S2. So this is A phase, this is B phase, and this is C phase. And what we have is VD, the DC voltage that we have given as input. The same kind of modulation technique can be used for the three-phase inverter as well. Only thing is, the modulating waves will become A phase, AN, and then BN will be 120 degree shifted from AN, and C phase will be shifted again 120 degrees away from BN. This is what is going to be the modulating waves for each of the phase. So I will have to have three different waveforms completely. This is for A phase, and for B phase, I'm going to have maybe the second one somewhat like this, and I'm going to have the third one somewhat like this. This is going to be the third phase. And these, each of these have to be compared with the triangular wave. So I may have to use a triangular wave which is of very high frequency like this. So I can compare the triangular wave with A phase, B phase, and C phase respectively, independent of each other. And I should be firing device number S1 and S4, or S3 and S6, corresponding to B phase and C phase, and so on. So what we use in this case will be normally bipolar. That's what I want to underline again. Normally what we use in this case will be bipolar, unlike what we do in the other case. So if I am going to have two devices conducting simultaneously, maybe S1 and S6, so what I get will be VD by 2 in this portion, another VD by 2 in this portion. That's what I will get, because that is what will be A phase voltage with respect to the neutral of the load. If I assume that the load is, you know, balanced, then VD is applied across. So VD is applied across A phase and B phase load. So I'm going to get A phase voltage to be VD by 2 and B phase voltage to be VD by 2. We already said that if I use sinusoidal PWM technique in bipolar modulation technique, we are going to get the output to be proportional to the amplitude modulation index, right? So if I try to look at what is A phase voltage, it will be whatever is the modulation index multiplied by VD by 2, right? This will be proportional to this. And this is essentially the peak of the fundamental, because essentially I am using this as the modulating wave. My modulating wave is essentially a sinusoidal wave, and the peak of the sine wave divided by the triangular wave peak is my modulation index. So if I try to look at what is the A phase peak of the fundamental voltage, that will be close to M multiplied by VD by 2. So this is going to be peak of the fundamental A phase voltage or phase voltage. So if I want what is line voltage, RMS, not peak, what I need to do is M multiplied by root 3 multiplied by Vd by 2. This will be the peak of line voltage. And if I want RMS, I have to divide by root 2. So I am going to get the line voltage RMS to be m multiplied by root 3 divided by root 2, roughly. And if m is 1, at which I don't want to drop any pulses, I don't want to go into overmodulation, the maximum voltage I will get for no overmodulation, the maximum modulation index is equal to 1. So I can say line voltage RMS for m equal to 1 or modulation index equal to 1 will be root 3 by 2 root 2 multiplied by Vd. If you calculate this, it will come out to be about 60% or 61%. So it will be only about 0.6 times or 0.6. To be precise, it is 0.1612 or something multiplied by Vd. So if I have 560 or 600 volts as the DC voltage, and if I use a bipolar sinusoidal PWM technique, I will not get more than about 60% of whatever is my DC link voltage. So if I want about 360 volts or 400 volts, I need to essentially say the DC link voltage has to be 400 divided by 0.612. That is the reason why we normally use a very, very high DC link voltage for most of the three-phase inverter configuration. We use something like 650 or 700 volts all the time. So whenever we try to use a three-phase inverter at 400 volts level, RMS, line-to-line voltage level, the DC link voltage as a rule in sinusoidal PWM technique has to be as high as 700 volts, close to 700 volts. So this is one of the major problems of sinusoidal PWM technique, where we underutilize the DC bus. We design it for a very, very large value, and ultimately what we get at the output is much, much smaller. This is one of the problems of sinusoidal PWM technique. We will look at how to improve the situation, how to utilize the DC link better in the next couple of classes. So we will meet on Monday, of course, regular class, and Tuesday at 5 o'clock for an extra class. Tuesday at 5 o'clock, we are meeting for an extra class. I'll let you know where the class is by booking the room. Thank you.